to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10 this morning. If you don't have a Bible with you, we've got one there in front of you in the pew. We invite you to take that and turn with us to Romans chapter 10. In the pew Bible there, that's page 957, I believe. And I thought I wrote that down on here, but I didn't. So 957, I believe. Romans chapter 10. We've been speaking recently about this idea. This month, we've been talking about the theme of being relevant. How can we, as God's people, be relevant? And we make the distinction that truth, God's word, is always relevant. We don't have to try to make God's word relevant because the truth is always relevant. But you know what? We, as God's people, the question is, how can we be relevant to those around us? In other words, how can we make a difference? How can we make a difference in the lives of those around us? And this month we've looked at many things the Bible says that make a difference. Obviously the Bible says compassion makes a difference. And if some have compassion making a difference, Jude 22. The Bible says that love makes a difference. The love in our heart for others, it makes a difference. You know, today we're going to look at something. Honestly, I wrestled with it this week. And I thought about how God's been dealing with me in my prayer life. And so today we're going to talk about this idea of making a difference through prayer. Making a difference through prayer. How can I make a difference in someone else's life? Compassion. Going the second mile. But prayer makes a difference. How many of you would raise your hand with me and say, I know at least one time where I prayed and God answered my prayer. Just raise your hand if you know that God at least answered one of your prayers. Amen. You know, and it doesn't matter sometimes the significance. Sometimes we have big prayers and big requests, and God answers those. Sometimes it's just a small thing that we consider small, and God answers that. But I had an interesting day yesterday. I went on a walk, walked my ferocious hound, my 10-pound Yorkie Poo, and we went to a nature preserve nearby, and we walked, and there's a fella sitting on one of the benches, and I walked past him the first time, and God's like, you need to talk to him. You know, I reasoned it away and just kept walking and walked past him the second time. God's like, you really need to talk to him. And so I said, if we make this loop and he's still there, I'll talk to him. And he was there, so I stopped and made some small talk with the guy. And I asked him what his religious background was. And he told me that he didn't have much of a religious background because one time when he was a child, he prayed. Something very serious, by the way. It wasn't like, you know, prayed because my dog's sick. It was something very serious in his life. And he prayed one time, and he says God didn't answer his prayer. He says we gave up on God. And so we talked for a little while and just tried to encourage him that, you know, God is good. And God, while he may not have answered that prayer the way we want, you know, God's still a good guy. I just tried to reason with him and talk to him about the Lord a little bit. But that really struck me. Here's a man who's basing his belief on God and what he thinks about God, basing on the time when he was a child. He prayed one prayer, and in his view, God did not answer his prayer. And that really, as I've been thinking about this week and preparing this, that really made me think, God, how many prayers have I prayed that you didn't answer? And how many, or from my perspective, you know, from our perspective that God didn't answer it. How many prayers, God, did I pray that I'm thankful that you didn't give me what I asked for, right? How many of you say there's been times I've prayed for something and I'm glad God didn't give it to me? Yeah, me too. And so, because you know what that teaches me? That teaches me that God knows what's best. God knows, the Bible says, the plans that he has for us. He knows what is best for you and for me. But how can we make a difference through our prayers? I believe prayer makes a difference today. Dr. A.C. Dixon, he was a man who pastored both the Moody Memorial Chapel in Chicago and Spurgeon's Metropolitan Tabernacle in London. He pastored both of these churches. And one time he was speaking on prayer and he said, we rely upon organization and we get what organization can do. When we rely upon education, we get what education can do. When we rely upon eloquence, we get what eloquence can do. And so on. Nor am I disposed to under-evaluate any of these things in their proper place. But when we rely upon prayer, we get what God can do. Taking it to the Lord in prayer. He can do things that you and I cannot do. He can see things that you and I cannot see. He can change hearts that we could never change because He's God. And this morning, if we look at the Word of God here in Romans chapter 10, let's look at this with me, please. Romans chapter 10, Paul is writing this letter to the believers in Rome. And let's hear his heart this morning. He tells us that we're about to hear his heart. Look at Romans 10, beginning in verse 1. It says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God." Shall we pray this morning? Father, we thank you today for this time to set aside to look into your word. Lord, as we've said many times, as we read your word, you are speaking to us. You're talking to us. Lord, if you were to appear today in a physical form and have a conversation with us, we'd be so engaged. We'd write it down. We'd record it. We'd copy it down. We'd want to keep it. We'd pay so close attention. And yet, Lord, when we open your word, that's what happens. God, thank you for giving us your word and the fact that it's alive and that it's still speaking to hearts today. And God, based on that truth, based on the promise that your word is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of our hearts, Lord, I pray today that your word would convict the lost here in this room of their sin, that they'd see their need for Jesus, and Lord, that today at the end of this service, people who are lost will come forward and trust Jesus. Lord, we pray for that today. Lord, we pray that today for those who know Christ, that you will also discern the thoughts and the intents of our hearts. And God, as your Holy Spirit and your word speak this morning, I pray, God, that you would do a work in our lives. And that in that time of invitation, God, we would make right any wrong in our heart with you. God, please let our hearts be an open book for you to read and to work in this morning. Lord, I pray that you would perform your surgery on our hearts today. Change us. Create in us a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within us, dear God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Making a difference through prayer. You know, as we read the words of Paul and we see Paul's heart, we see it on paper, that his heart's desire and his prayer to God for Israel is that they would be saved. He wanted them to know Jesus. He wanted them to turn to Jesus Christ. You know, as we read his words, we come to realize that a grateful Christian will desire others to have what he has in Christ. A grateful Christian will desire for others to have what we have in Christ. As we look at what we've been blessed with, what we've been given by the grace of God, like Miss Bonnie sang about this morning, we've been given by the grace of God. I hope there's something in all of our hearts today that wants that for others. That there are people that we know who need it. And it bothers us. And it burdens us that they don't have it. I hope that that's in our heart today. I hope that as we pray and we think about others, that we shed a tear from time to time. How long has it been since we've wept for the lost? How long has it been since we genuinely prayed for somebody who didn't know Christ? Paul had a burden in his heart for the people of Israel. He had a desire for them, and his desire was that they'd be saved. He was grateful for his salvation. I wonder this morning, are we truly grateful for what we have? And the question for us to answer today is this: who am I praying for to be saved? Who am I praying for to be saved? Today we're going to read the heart desire of Paul, a man who had a burden for the lost around him. Let's look at the Word of God here, back again in verse 1. We're going to notice, first of all, we need to pray for those without Christ. Very basic principle, very basic concept, but a truth nonetheless, that we need to pray for those around us who are lost. Look at verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Now, it's good to have desires in our hearts. It's good to desire that lost people would be saved. I hope that every Christian in this room this morning desires for somebody that we know who's lost to be saved. And may I say today, if there's not somebody on our heart, or if there's not somebody that we think about from time to time and pray for from time to time, may I say that we're actually what the Bible would call backslidden? I know that's tough, but amen. If there's not somebody that we're thinking and praying for, we're a backslidden Christian. Because, friend, we have been given eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we ought to desire that for others. It's good to desire that. But Paul didn't just desire it, friend. He put his desires into actions. And one way that he put his desire into action was to pray for those without Christ. He didn't just have a desire, but that desire in his heart drove him to pray. You know, when we pray for something, it's something that we desire. If I have a friend who's going to be in surgery, a family member, a friend, many times we'll have prayer requests for people in here who are going to have procedures, surgeries, things like that. They have a tough time coming up this week. Maybe it's a test. Whatever may be going on. We desire for them that God would answer their prayers, so we pray for them. We desire that. We want that. We ought to want for the lost to be saved. And friend, when we really want something, we'll ask for it, won't we? When we really want something, we'll ask for it. How bad do I want them to be saved? Well, we can tell. How many times do we take it to the Lord in prayer? If my prayer life is all about what I want and what I need, I'm a very shallow believer. That's true. If my prayer time is about bless me, bless my home, give me health, give my kids health, God protect me, do this for me, if that's what my prayer life consists of, honestly, that's a very shallow prayer life and a very shallow heart. We see a man here who has a heart for others, a heart for the nation of Israel, and his heart drove him to pray. How often? Who am I praying for today to be saved? What do you and I desire for the lost? What do we want for the lost around us? I think that's a pretty easy question to answer. We want them to be saved. We want them to go to heaven. We want them to have eternal life. That's what we should want for them. Do we want somebody to tell them? Maybe that somehow they would hear the gospel. Do we think about them often? Do we pray for them regularly? Are we praying out of duty or from the heart? One thing I'm going to tell you today that God has been beating me up about in my prayer time is my duty of prayer versus my heart of prayer. And you know, we have prayer lists and stuff that we pray when we have our prayer time. We have people's names. There's nothing wrong with a prayer list. But something that God's been teaching me is praying through that list is fine, but is my heart in it? Am I really praying for them? And sometimes recently I've just been setting my list aside and just praying, you know. You say you might miss somebody. Well, God knows my heart. I'm praying from my heart. I'm praying that God would answer what's on my heart. God, praying for people, you know. I'm praying for individuals. I'm praying for this, that, or the other thing. But God's been beating me up about my heart in prayer. Is it just words I say because I'm praying, I'm concerned for somebody, or is it my heart? And Paul's prayers came out of his heart. That's obvious there in verse 1. Are we praying from our heart for the lost? You know, earnest, heartfelt prayers are far more effective than polished phrases and fancy words. And we're all kind of guilty of that, especially when we pray in public, you know. We maybe say things we wouldn't say in our, you know, in our personal prayer time, we say and try to be a little more eloquent. But, you know, I think more than being eloquent, God wants to hear our heart. And what's in our heart for people? What's in our heart for the lost? Praying because we're supposed to is fine, but praying because our hearts ache for them is a different thing. And we talked about how in Psalm 126, it talks about weeping. He that weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. You know, our hearts should break for the lost. Is my heart in my prayer for the lost people? Do we understand what's at stake in their life? An eternity in a real place called hell. Their need is to turn to Christ so they won't spend an eternity in hell. It ought to break our hearts. You know, a grateful Christian will desire for others what he has in Christ. And I wonder this morning, between me and God, between you and God, who are we praying for to be saved? Is there somebody we're praying for this morning? Second thing we'll notice in this passage this morning is not only do we need to pray for those without Christ, we need to introduce them to Christ. It's our duty to introduce them to Christ. Look at verse 2. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. They have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. What does that mean? Well, that means they like God. They like the things of God. They're kind of interested in the rituals and the traditions. Going to church for these kind of people is something they like to do. It's their duty. It's Sunday. I go to church. They have a zeal for God. If it's time for the communion or Lord's Supper, they're going to be there to take the communion and Lord's Supper. If it calls for them to be baptized, they're going to be baptized. When it comes to religious duties and religious ritual and the traditions that we do, they're involved in that. They have a zeal for God. They like God. They like what he's about. They like to do those things, but not according to knowledge. They don't know God, you see. There's a difference. There's a big difference in liking God and being about God and knowing God. You know, there's a difference in liking our favorite ball player or golfer or ball team. We might like them. There's a difference in liking them and getting to know them, right? There's a difference. I had the opportunity a couple weeks ago to meet Kentucky's head basketball coach. Don't throw anything at me, okay? It's okay. And you know, I know about them. I watched the team, you know. I know about him a little bit. Got to meet him. I asked him one question, and he kind of laughed at me. Not in a condescending way, but he just kind of laughed a little bit with me. Gave me a funny answer. But there's a difference in knowing about people and knowing him. I can't say I know him, obviously. I don't know him. I know about him. I have a zeal for Kentucky basketball, but I don't know him. I don't know them. There's a difference. There's a difference in liking church and liking God and liking the songs and liking the choir. Yay, it's Sunday. And knowing God. And there are some people who like the stuff, who have a zeal about it, but they don't know God. And that's what he's talking about here. You know about Israel. God chose them. He's blessed them. He's been so good to them. He's been so good to his people. He's got a plan that they'll be saved at the end. You know, Romans chapter 11 tells us that. But listen. They don't know him. They don't know his son Jesus, God in the flesh. Friend, there's people around us who have a zeal for God, but they don't know him. And quite honestly, God put on my heart today that there's people here today who have a zeal for God, but don't know him. You wouldn't miss church if your life depended on it, but you don't know God. Would you be saved today? Do you know Christ? You might know all about him, but do you know him? Have you trusted him? Have you placed your faith in him? There's a difference. Folks, we won't make a difference if we won't pray. A powerful witness of the gospel begins with a powerful prayer life for others. Who am I praying for to be saved? Who did God put on my heart this morning as I thought about this question? Who's the name? Who's the face? Are you praying for them? Because a grateful Christian will desire for others what he has in Christ. Third and finally this morning, we're going to notice that Christless people need our prayers and our efforts. Christless people need our prayers and our efforts. Look at verse 3. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. They're trying. They're trying to get there. They're doing. They don't know better. and they're not going to know unless somebody tells them. You know, most people won't know about Jesus Christ unless we introduce them to Him. That's a fact. We're not living in 1950s America anymore, where everybody goes to church and everybody knows the Bible and everybody knows about God. We're not living in that era anymore. This has been probably 20, maybe 15, 20 years ago. We had a special speaker at the high school over in Coleraine. He came, and as you know, if people go to talk in a school, in a public school, they can't talk about religious things. He was doing a talk on drugs and staying away from drugs. At the end, he was going to invite the kids back to the church that night where he could preach the gospel to them. And he said at the end of his talk on drugs, he said, "I want to invite you all tonight to the church down the street here. We're going to meet at 7 o'clock. We're going to have pizza. And I'm going to talk again." He was like, "And I want to introduce you to a man who is from Galilee who will change your life." All the way from Israel. This is no joke. There was a boy that went home. I think he was a sophomore. Went home and told his dad, "I got to go up to that church tonight. There's supposed to be a guy coming all the way from Israel, from Galilee, who's going to change my life. I got to meet him." Kid had no clue who God, who Jesus was, what the Bible was. And that was 15, 20 years ago. Listen, when you meet people, they just don't automatically know Adam and Eve and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and David. And you know, they don't know that. We're not living in the same world as it was 60 years ago. In today's American society, people aren't going to know Jesus if we don't introduce them to Him. Our prayers and our efforts matter, but listen, our efforts aren't going to matter much if we're not praying. Listen, it's just like a garden. If you don't toil the soil and you don't turn that soil a little bit and get in there and stir it up and get it all prepared and plant the seed and water the seed and make sure it has sunlight and take good care of that area, if you don't do that, there's nothing going to grow. And we're cultivating hearts with the gospel. We have to get in there and start the reaping process. Start the sowing process. We have to go in and start the sowing process. We have to break down walls that have never been around since these times in America till now. It's a slow process, but it's worth it because it's for the souls of men and women and boys and girls. And one way that we can kind of stir up the soil, friend, is by prayer. Heartfelt, genuine, maybe a tear will drop, prayer for the lost around us. Who are we praying for to be saved? Paul's heart's desire and prayer for Israel is that they might be saved. You know, I think about all the times that on Tuesday evenings when our people write letters and they go out, and I know there's many people who have signed up out in the vestibule to take materials home and to write letters and to make visits. Our efforts are good, but listen, our prayers have to support those efforts. Are you praying for that? You know, you say, "Brother Keller, I can't go on Tuesday nights. I just don't have it in me anymore to do that." Would you on Tuesday nights commit from 6:30 to 7:30 to pray for those who are? Would you commit not just to pray for them, but to pray for the people they'll be talking to and writing to and meeting? Maybe you could say, "I can sit at home and I can pray for an hour for the lost." Because listen, we're looking at a gospel-starved community. It's true. A community that hasn't had somebody come and knock on their door and say, "Hey, we're from the church down the street. Just want to let you know that we're here for you. Want to also ask you a question. If you were to die today, are you sure you'd go to heaven? You know, Jesus died for you. He loves you. I want to introduce..." They haven't had that in a long time, okay? And now that there's people who are writing and visiting and going, listen, that's kind of a shock to them a little bit. What are you here for? What are you asking me? They need to have God go before them and stir the hearts of the people they're going to meet. Maybe you would pray, "God, soften their hearts before they get that letter. God, soften their hearts before they get that visit. Prepare them for it." Ask God to prepare the people, prepare the soil of their hearts for the seed of the gospel. Prayer makes a difference. Prayer makes a difference. And Paul's heart desire and his prayer for Israel is that they would be saved. A grateful Christian will desire for others what he has in Christ. Who am I praying for today? I'll read this quote and we'll be finished. John Bunyan said this: "You can do more than pray after you have prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed." I want to say that again because that's really an interesting thought. You can do more than pray after you have prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed. May our efforts to share the gospel of Jesus Christ be born out of a heart of prayer. So what's our response going to be to what God has said to our hearts this morning? Now's the time to respond. This is called the invitation. So I'm going to ask you to stand with me, please. Our musicians are going to come. How are we going to respond this morning? There's two ways we can respond. Actually, there's three ways we can respond. Number one, if you're here today and you're not saved, you're not going to heaven, you know in your heart that you don't know Jesus Christ your Savior, you've never placed your faith in Him, maybe you're confused about the whole thing and you have no idea where you're going to go when you die. Today, right now, is an opportunity for you. In just a minute, Brother Tim's going to begin to sing. When he begins to sing, you are invited to step out into the aisle wherever you are, to come forward. I'll be right down here. You can just say, "Pastor, I need to be saved."